السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر، آمين يا رب العالمين. ثم أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. هذا بلاغ للناس ولينذروا به وليعلموا أنما هو إله واحد وليذكر أولو الألباب. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا إله إلا الله، آمين يا رب العالمين. I have a monumental task before me today to share with you in two parts of this presentation, broken up with a break in the middle, a huge subject. And I was given a different title before and I requested it to be changed, even though the subject is very similar. I was given the title Miracles of the Quran, and that's too big a title for me to handle. So I changed it to Literary Characteristics of the Quran, those of you that saw the advertising materials. There's a reason for which I chose this title, and I'd like to share with you why in this introductory phase of my talk. I'll center it around one thing. I've taken the Arabic portion of a small portion of the ayah that I recited to you in the beginning, هذا بلاغ للناس. Allah speaks about the Quran and He says this is a balagh, and I'm not going to translate that yet. It is a balagh for people. Balagh. Balagh in Arabic means that which reaches someone else. A communication, a communicate. This Quran is meant to reach people. It is a message to people. Now, because Allah calls it a means of communication or a communique, a message, I wanted to speak to you today first about the essential components of communication. I want to keep this very, very simple. I'm not going to try to bother you with heavy grammatical terms or Arabic terminology because that's not my intention today. What I want you to be exposed to is this dimension of an appreciation of the Quran that is almost lost entirely upon people who are not students of the Quran in Arabic, which is the majority of Muslims and perhaps all of mankind in addition. They don't appreciate one dimension of the Quran that I'd like to highlight for you. When we communicate, there are essentially three components that you have to keep in mind. There are three aspects to communicating. The first of them is the speaker himself. You know, when I'm talking to you, there's already, before I even open my mouth, because of my appearance, my gender, my age, all of that which you see with your eyes, you haven't even heard me speak yet, but you've already passed some judgment. You've already passed some sort of predisposed conclusions about how I'm going to speak or what I'm going to talk about. Think about it this way. I have kids, right? And, you know, when tax season comes around, I go speak to my friends that are accountants and I'm taking their financial advice, whatever. What if my six-year-old came to me and gave me tax advice? Really good tax advice. But it came from my six-year-old. Would I take it seriously? No. Not because what she says is wrong, but because it's coming from a source that I don't really acknowledge for that content. I don't expect it from her. Now, if I get that same exact financial advice from a financial advisor, from an accountant, from an auditor, will I take that advice seriously? Sure. It's going to completely change the way I perceive that information. So the speaker is a big deal. I'll give you a more relevant example as far as the religion is concerned. My kid doesn't give me financial advice, by the way. So, you come to a khutbah. You go to a masjid, you're attending a khutbah. You got there a little late, so you didn't get into the main hall. You sat outside by the shoes or something. So you didn't see the khatib. The khatib happened to be this young guy, wearing jeans and a t-shirt, baseball hat on backwards, barely a beard on his face, and he gives the most killer khutbah you've ever heard in your life. The people that are sitting in the front row, as they're listening to the khutbah, you know what they're thinking? Man, I better repeat my salah right after he's done. And the people that are outside that haven't seen him, that heard this khutbah, you know what they're thinking? I wonder where the shaykh studied. I wonder where he's from. That was amazing. What was the shaykh's name? Why? Because the one who speaks certainly affects how we understand what they're saying. This is a human flaw, but nonetheless it's there. It's there. Is this applicable even in the Quran? Absolutely. The Quran, as we go forward, you're going to see the Quran elicited two kinds of responses. Either people were mesmerized by this book and fell in love with this book and were willing to change their entire lives when they heard this book. It had that power on them. On the other hand, you had people that were so annoyed with this book. They had such a deeply rooted hatred for this book that they would do anything to get it from being spread across to the other people. Two responses. There was no apathy. There was nobody that heard the Quran and said, sounds interesting. That didn't exist. There were only one of these two responses. Now, I want to share with you something on this, about the who speaks component of communication, briefly. You know, in the Quran, Allah says, ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا. Allah struck an example. Now, just to see if you're paying attention, who struck the example? Allah. Allah. So who's the speaker, therefore? Allah is. Clear. Allah strikes the example, and of course, when you're a believer, I say to you, I give you an example. You say, okay, yeah, nice example. But if I say Allah gives an example, Allah strikes an example, don't you pay more attention? You do, because what did we take into consideration? The speaker, Allah. But the disbeliever on the other side of the spectrum, who the messenger is communicating the same Quran to, if he hears Allah struck an example, he already tunes his ears out. He says, I don't want to hear this, what Allah has to say. I've heard enough already. You've been telling me for a decade now. I don't want to hear it anymore. You understand? The only reason he's refusing to listen to the example is what? The speaker. The same reason for which the believer will pay extra attention is the same reason for which the disbeliever will be extra deterred. You follow? In Surah Al-Hajj, now Madani Quran Surah Al-Tahrim, Allah strikes an example. Madani Quran Baqarah, Allah struck an example. Daraballahu mathalan. But then when you come to Surah Al-Hajj, it's a Makki Surah. The majority of communication is taking place between the messenger and the vast majority of people that don't believe in what he has to say yet. Allah says to them, Ya ayyuhan nas, people, listen up. Duriba mathalun. Now listen to the English, rough English translation carefully. Allah says, people, an example has been struck. He says, an example has been struck. Who has been omitted from this discussion? The speaker. He didn't say Allah struck an example. What did he say? An example has been struck. He took the speaker out of the picture. You know why? Because when the disbeliever would hear that the speaker is Allah, all of a sudden, the rest of the text would become irrelevant. They would tune out. So Allah Azza wa Jalla in that ayah, instead of emphasizing the speaker, He emphasizes something else. And that's the next component of communication. What is being said? The speech itself. Simple words, the content. Two components so far of speech. The speaker and the content. Two things, the speaker and the content. So when Allah says an example is being struck, what's He emphasizing? The content. Listen to the example, forget where it's coming from. Don't judge the speaker, judge what? The speech. Judge the words themselves, right? So there's a difference in communication. Now this is of course taken into consideration consistently throughout the Quran. This is just one small example that I shared with you, but it's something very consistent. And the Quran is very conscious of this problem of communication. To the point we find an interesting statement, almost an axiom of Ali radiallahu anhu, a companion of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who said something very interesting. I'll paraphrase it in English for you. We judge the speech before we judge the speaker. He says we judge what is said before we judge who says it. Because it's perhaps from the most unlikely source that you will find the truth. You'll find the truth. One of the reasons for rejecting Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that he was an orphan and he wasn't a celebrity in the town and he wasn't one of the two great leaders that everybody already looked up to. This was one of the reasons that the kuffar gave. Who is he to speak? Why should we listen to him? And this is actually recorded in the Quran. You know, one of the two men, min al-qariyatayni azim, one of the two great men from the towns. Why weren't they picked? Why would this man be picked to deliver a message? So two components so far, let's see if you're still paying attention, what are they? The speaker and the speech. Here's the third component. How do they say it? It's who says, what they say, and the third part, how do they say it? If I give you advice, study harder. Right? Your exams are coming over, coming upon you, and your mom comes to you, your best friend comes to you and says, "You're such a loser. You're wasting all your time. You're pathetic, you know." And they mean to tell you, study. Now, they gave you good advice, but the way in which they gave it made it ineffective. So it's not just that you have the speaker and the content, but the way in which you present the content has to be effective. Otherwise, the effect is lost. The communication is lost. In the end, the point of communication is to influence the audience. Not just to have them listen to some things or see some things, but to actually influence them, to influence a change in them. You can't do that if you don't speak effectively, even if you have something good to say. Let me give you another example. You listen to a khutbah, incredible content. But the way in which it is delivered is extremely monotone. Now the content itself is profound. Ayat of Quran are being quoted, a hadith are being quoted, really powerful statements are being stated, but the way in which they are being stated is so boring that you will find half the audience passed out. You will. And there's nothing wrong with the content, because the content is divine. There may not even be anything wrong with the speaker, but what's the problem that time? The mode of speech, the style of speech, how something is being presented. Three components of speech. The first one, the speaker. Second one, the content, the speech. The third one, the style, how they speak, the medium. In media studies, this is given so much importance. The first axiom you learn when you study media is the medium is the message. The way you present is equally important, if not more important than how you present. It's equally important. So now, with that basic introduction, when we turn to the Quran, then we ask ourselves, and we ask ourselves the revisiting the question, the Quran is a miracle. We believe this. The Quran is remarkable. We believe this. The Quran is, you know, it's stunning in its beauty. We believe this. And it's stunning as communication, but it's stunning in three ways. It's remarkable and incredible in three ways. It's remarkable in that the speaker is incredible. The speaker himself. What else is incredible? The speech. What else is incredible? The style. There are three things. Now let's turn to the speaker briefly, okay? The speaker in the Quran is who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But additionally, I want you to think about this. The disbeliever who hears the messenger reciting Quran does not believe that it's from Allah. Who does he believe the speaker is? The disbeliever believes, or he thinks, that the speaker is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For the believer, he knows that the messenger is only a medium by which the words are being delivered, and the words belong to Allah. So the messenger is actually quoting sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's quoting Allah. But the disbeliever says, these are not Allah's words, because if he said that, he'd be a Muslim already. He wouldn't be a disbeliever anymore. So now think of it from this point of view. The believer understands that the actual speaker is Allah, which is miraculous enough for the believer. But let's look at it from the disbeliever's point of view. From the disbeliever's point of view, who's the speaker? Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now keep that perspective in mind. This is important. Because Allah says this is a communication not just for believers, but for who? How did I begin this talk? This is communication for all people. And the vast majority of people believe already that these are not words of Allah, that these are words of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even then it is miraculous. Perspective in mind, this is important. Because Allah says this is a communication not just for believers, but for who? How did I begin this talk? This is communication for all people. And the vast majority of people believe already that these are not words of Allah, that these are words of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even then it is miraculous. What about Muhammad's background, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, gives away that he can't be the speaker. And if he is, there's something, you know, unusual taking place. There is knowledge of the history of Bani Israel. Just a side note, this is not the subject of my speech, it's just a side note. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes and he starts giving this information that exists in the classified texts of the people of the book. By the way, the people of the book now thump Bible studies. They want you to read the Bible. What the Bible, Jehovah's Witness will come to you with a little pamphlet that says, what does the Bible really say? Right? But the ancient Christian was not well read in the Bible. Bible studies was limited to biblical scholars. And if you had a question about the Bible, you didn't go and look it up yourself. Where did you go? You went to the priest. You went to the rabbi for the Old Testament. It was classified information. It's almost like it was considered so high class or so difficult to access for yourself. It's kind of like reading the United States Constitution for yourself. You go to a lawyer to interpret it. You go to somebody who studied that stuff. It's their thing. It's not your thing, right? The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam starts saying things that existed only in their classified documents, and only their higher level scholars would discuss them, and he's just uttering those words. So already they knew that he's actually not the speaker. They realized very quickly that he can't possibly be the speaker. He can't be. Just on this point, just a side note, the historicity of the Qur'an, the historical integrity of the Qur'an, Haman. You know who Haman is in the Qur'an? He's the minister, or one of the ministers of who? Of Fir'aun. Haman is mentioned in the Qur'an about 6 times. And Allah tells us about Haman, that Fir'aun commanded him to build him a tower. Fir'aun commanded him to build him a tower. Now, is there a mention of a Haman in the Bible? Sure. Is there a mention of Haman building a tower? Sure. But the Haman in the Bible didn't work for Fir'aun. He worked for another king named Xerxes in the biblical book of Esther. So the biblical Catholic scholars in the 1600s, who were first getting into Orientalist studies, Islamic studies, they look this thing up in the Qur'an and say, aha, we found a mistake in the Qur'an. Look, they're talking about Haman working under Fir'aun, while the book of Esther tells us that Haman worked under the king named Xerxes 1,000 years after the Pharaoh in Babylon, not even in Egypt, and he built them a tower. You ever heard of the story, the Tower of Babylon? So they challenged the historical integrity of the Qur'an. Ma'adallah, they said from the disbeliever's point of view, oh, Muhammad must have plagiarized it from a priest and made a mistake because he mixed up the story of the Tower of Babel, right? And the story of Xerxes with the story of the Pharaoh, and he's confused between the two of them. That's what he did. Misquotation in the Qur'an. What's really interesting is, in the late 1800s, the Catholic scholarship, the body of Catholic scholarship, unanimously denied the book of Esther as a valid source of history. They acknowledged their own book, they acknowledged that their own book, unanimously, is legend, just stories made up, names made up. The Jewish encyclopedia even now tells you the book of Esther has no historical value. None whatsoever. But then it remains, this one question remains. The Qur'an tells us that this Qur'an tells Bani Israel about the things that even they disagreed in. Even they disagreed in some stuff, and this Qur'an tells them. This speaker is giving this to you, he can't be the speaker then. This knowledge is coming from somewhere else. Now check this out. You know Maurice Bukhari, this famous Muslim who wrote Bible, Qur'an and science? Before he got into that subject, he was a historian. He wanted to study Islamic history. When he came across this problem presented by Catholic priests, he did a little research. You see, what happened in the late 1800s was the Egyptian hieroglyphics were now being revived as a language, because hieroglyphics had died. About almost 2,000 years before the Prophet ﷺ, Egyptian hieroglyphics had died as a language. And they were revived by German and French scholars. The study is called Egyptology. They traveled to Egypt, they studied the hieroglyphics, and they developed a scheme of, you know, spelling those images and turning them into pronounceable words and all this stuff. Okay, it started about 120, 130 years ago. So they got into this study, and they made documentations of who the ministers that are mentioned in the documents of the Egyptians, what their roles were, etc., etc. Maurice travels to France, goes to an Egyptologist and asks him, by the way, in your records, did you see any name Haman? And he says, well, I wouldn't know, you have to go to Germany, but where did you get the name Haman? He said, well, there's a messenger, a man who claims to be a messenger, in the 7th century, who says that there was a minister of Pharaoh, whose name was what? Haman. And he told him to build a tower. He said, that's impossible. Nobody could have had access to any names from that time, because the language has already died at the Prophet's time for how long already? 2,000 years. So he travels to Germany. to look up the names of different architects and constructors and ministers under the name, under the Pharaoh, specifically under the Pharaoh at the time of historical era of Musa alayhi salam, of Moses. What does he find? Haman, minister of the stone quarries, construction. This name is discovered in the 1900s. They actually have a statue in Austria, I believe. Haman written on it underneath. They revived it from Egypt. His name is Haman in Austria. The statue is sitting there. Now we don't know for sure if that's the Haman of the Quran, but still the name exists. The fact that he's in charge of construction exists. And this is something they didn't have, but which speaker had? The Messenger of Allah, but actually the speaker is who then? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is just from the historical point of view. Something that they used to laugh at the Muslims came back and blew up in their own face. SubhanAllah. This is just one dimension. But the dimension I want to focus on with you today is not the first or the second. The second is the content. But it's the third. Not what Allah says, not just that alone, but how He says it. What makes the Quran so unique in the way in which it communicates? The way in which Allah says stuff is so powerful and so incredible. You see, the Quran, when it's translated, maybe you'll get the content of what he says. Maybe. What will you definitely not get 100%? How he said it. That's lost. What he said, maybe you get something out of translation. Maybe. But how he said it is gone. That's it. Because how he said it exists in what language? In Arabic. Even if you explain it to somebody in Arabic, in your own Arabic, it's still not how he said it. You understand? So the creative beauty, the unique beauty, the unparalleled majesty really of Allah's words, they cannot be translated. Something from the meaning can be translated. But the actual impact that the original words have, nothing else can have. In appreciating this gap between our attempts to translate the Quran and Allah's own words, appreciate this gap. You know what As-Suyuti rahimahullah said? He said, if you can appreciate the distance between Allah and His creation, meaning how far above Allah is from His creation, then you have some idea of the distance between the word of Allah and the word of the creation. What is translation? It is the word of creation. It can never be a substitute for the word of Allah. It can't be. This is not a lecture on what is lost in the content. We could talk about that too. There's a lot lost in the content too. But I want to talk to you about what is lost in the beauty, in the style. And how can we as non-Arab speaking audiences, as people that aren't exposed to the Arabic language, at least even begin that journey of appreciating the Quran in that light. That is something that has been held dearly by Muslims for a very, very, very long time and is almost entirely lost upon the Muslims in our times. You see, when we hear that the Qur'an is a miracle, as we heard in the introduction before I got up here, how is the miracle of the Qur'an presented? Mostly, if you Google it, the first thing you'll get is scientific phenomena in the Qur'an. Isn't that true? Another thing you might get is some crazy number 19 theory. Right? You'll get that. Some statistics. Another thing you might get is the Qur'an had predictions, like Rome is going to be, it was dominated, but it will come back and take over again. Predictions in the Qur'an. But do we believe that every ayah of the Qur'an is a miracle? Do we believe that? Is it a miracle from the very time it was revealed or later on? From then. From its inception, from the very first communication we had with the Qur'an, the first interaction human beings had with the Qur'an, every last ayah of the Qur'an is a miracle. This is what we believe. How many ayat of Qur'an are predictions? Very few. How many ayat of Qur'an are dedicated to scientific phenomena? Very few. How many of these things were even known to the Arabs of that time? Almost nothing. So what is it that mesmerized these people? What is it that every time the messenger opened his mouth, that they would be, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they would be dumbfound. They didn't know what to say. Three stories and I'm done with the introduction, inshallah ta'ala. This is the question we're going to try and answer in the second part. The first story, very interesting, is the story of Tufayl ibn Amr al-Dawsi. Interesting fellow. He was the leader of his tribe. He was also a very skillful poet. And he decided to pay his respects to Mecca, to visit and make, you know, tawaf of the house. All Arabs had shared regard for what city? for Makkah. So to show their dedication, he would, to show his dedication, he came as the leader of his tribe. The leaders of Quraysh realize that he's coming. And when he comes, he might hear the Prophet ﷺ reciting Quran. And if that happens, he might get enchanted. So we better protect another tribe leader from falling at the hand of Muhammad ﷺ, because when a tribe leader becomes Muslim, who also follows? The whole tribe. So you gotta take care of business. They go to meet him outside Makkah before he even comes in. They say to him, listen, we've got a problem in the city right now. There's this man, he says these words, and they cast spells on people. It turns father against son, husband against wife, brother against brother. It is causing disunity in our tribe. These people are being possessed by demons when he speaks to them. We think you're an important figure for your tribe. We think that your integrity is going to be compromised if he's able to cast his spells on you. We advise you to go back. We don't want you to come into Makkah. He's hesitating to go, but he says, no, I came all this way. I'm at least going to go and make tawaf. I'm going to pay my respects to the house and then go. They said, fine, but at least take this cork. They gave him a couple of plugs. For what? If you see him, you'll recognize those words. And when you hear those words, just plug your ears and run. This is the advice they gave him. He goes in, he's paying his respects to the house. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is there praying, reciting Quran. He hears the sweetness of the words and he recognizes immediately this must be what they were talking about. So what does he do? He plugs his ears and makes a dash for it. And halfway in his jog, he stops and he thinks to himself, I am the leader of my tribe. I'm the pride of my people. I'm one of the most skillful poets in all of Arabia. Some words are going to overpower me. I can take this. He unplugs his ears. He goes back to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He listens to the Quran. He takes the shahada and then tells the story. Subhanallah. That's how we know the story. It was alluded to before. Abu Jahl, Abu Sufyan, Akhnas ibn Shuraiq, these three people would hate on the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were the elders of the Quraysh. They were the seniors. They were the think tank. And they would sneak in the middle of the night and put their ears on the Prophet's apartment sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They would listen to Quran being recited. And then they would sneak back before morning. And what happened the first night was they ran into each other. And the other didn't know the other was there. So the first guy is going, what are you doing here? He says, well, what are you doing here? So, right? They knew what they were doing there. So they swore they will never come back. They caught each other the next night. They swore they won't come back. They caught each other the third night. They catch each other the third night and they swear by their mothers, by their Lord, by their lives, they're never going to come back again. So they don't come back. But Akhnas, he's curious. He goes to Abu Sufyan and he says to him, we've been listening for 3 days. What do you think? Is this the truth? Abu Sufyan says to him, by the way, Abu Sufyan became Muslim much later. This is early seerah. Of course it's the truth. What else can it be? Okay, let's go talk to Abu Jahl. He's been listening too, right? So the two of them go and they talk to Abu Jahl. What do you think? Of course it's the truth. Abu Jahl says, of course it's the truth. But then he explained. You see, we're Banu Amir. And he's Banu Hashim. Right there, before I tell you any more of what he said, what did he take into consideration? The speech or the speaker? But then he explained. You see, we're Banu Amir. And he's Banu Hashim. Right there, before I tell you any more of what he said, what did he take into consideration? The speech or the speaker? The rejection of the disbeliever came at the fact that these words, as powerful as they are, as true as they are, as flawless as the content is, as mesmerizing as the style is, we are not willing to accept this person. Because when Banu Hashim gives charity, we match them. When they fight, we match them. When they show bravery, we match them. When one of theirs comes up with these words, we will never match them. So they have won forever, we can't let that happen. That was the reason. Subhanallah. It's a different take on history. Even those who hated the Qur'an were mesmerized by the Qur'an. Even they were mesmerized by the Qur'an. Last story. This is one of my favorites. Utbah ibn Rabi'ah. You can think of Uthman ibn Rabi'a as the Sean Hannity of back in the day. Okay? Expert debater, very insulting to those who oppose him in public discourse. He was a negotiator on behalf of conflicting tribes. He was hired for that. He was a consultant, you could say, that would go in and make demands and get the thing done, you know? These are the kind of people that Quraysh, when they said this war of words, we're losing. So we got to get somebody who's really good at their words. Somebody really good at debate and discussion and negotiation. So they hired Utbah. And they say, go Utbah, you talk to Muhammad. He's sitting there, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Of course, they didn't say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You go talk to him. You make some demands on him. Figure out what he wants. Humiliate him, by the way. We'll watch from a distance. Nowadays, we watch football games from a stadium or from the, you know, our couches on TV. This was their sport. To watch one want to go against the other in this debate, right? So they're watching from a distance. They don't want to get too close, but they're about to enjoy this matchup between Utbah ibn Rabi'ah and who? Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Utbah goes very insulting, extremely condescending. Ya Muhammad, what do you want? You want wealth? We'll give you money. You want women? We'll give you women. You want shared power? We'll give you some power too. What do you want? Make your demands. Now by already saying that, he is not judging the content of what Muhammad says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He never made any demands of money, nor of anything else. He is not judging anything but the intentions, the person. This is called character assassination. The best way you can dismantle somebody or somebody's credibility is that you attack their motives. Why are you really presenting this message? You must have some alternative agenda hiding underneath. Which is why you're talking this way. So he rats off, barks like a dog at the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The messenger is listening carefully and silently, patiently. And when he's done in very small, very soft tones, the messenger says to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَفَرَغْتِ يَا أَبَا وَلِيدٍ? Are you done? Are you finished? He says, fine, your turn. The messenger, alayhi salatu wa sallam, did nothing but recite Qur'an. He recites from Surah Fussilat. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم حاميم تنزيل من الرحمن الرحيم. The first thing he says, it is a revelation, rough translation. Of course, I can't match what Allah says, but a rough translation. It is something that has been sent down from the exceedingly merciful, the constantly merciful. The intention, when the attack came from Utbah, the idea was these are your words and you're just trying to get something out of it. The first thing the Quran says in response is what? This is not my words, where are they from? Up there, you're not negotiating with me. Who are you debating right now? Allah Azza wa Jalla. You're not fighting me, you're fighting Allah's words. These are His, they're sent down to me. تَنْزِيلٌ مِّنَ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ كِتَابٌ. It's a book, it's actually a book. Right now it's being presented at words, but where does it come from? From kitab. فُصِّلَتْ آيَاتُهُ. Whose ayat, whose demands have been made absolutely clear. Remember, he asked about demands, right? What do you want? Allah says the ayat are absolutely clear. The ayat make certain demands. Now what are those demands in? Are they in clear language? قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا لِقَوْمٍ يَعْلَمُونَ. An Arabic Qur'an for a nation that seeks to know. You want to know what we want? You want to know what Allah wants? You want to know what the demands are? Here they are, they're coming. Then Allah Azza wa Jal, He reveals the ayah بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا. This Qur'an came, it's two main functions. Bashir, you know what that means? Something that gives good news. It comes with good news for you. It's got a good proposition for you. وَنَذِيرًا. And a warning, a threat. وَنَذِيرًا. فَأَعْرَضَ أَكْثَرُهُمْ فَهُمْ لَا يَسْمَعُونَ. But most of them ignore it on purpose. إعراض is to ignore something on purpose. They don't even listen. And they're the ones who are actually not listening. They think you're not listening to them, but the real dumb, the real, you know, people incapable of hearing are those people over there. They're the ones that are not listening. فَهُمْ لَا يَسْمَعُونَ. So Allah is responding to His negotiation with ayat of Qur'an. And as the ayat are being revealed, the people are watching from a distance, right? They don't hear what's going on, but they see what's going on. They see the face of Utbah change. They see his face change. Then what they notice is he's crying. Utbah started crying. Their expert negotiator, kafir, hater of Islam, insulter of the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. La'anahullah. He listens to Quran and he starts crying. He cries so much as the ayat go on and they get stronger and stronger in their wording that he tries to grab the mouth of the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, please stop. Can't take any more. The messenger kept on reciting sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until he reached the ayah of sajda. And he made sajda. He comes back, Utbah walks back from this debate. This expert negotiator of the Quraysh, who their hopes were lying in. And he comes back and they say, your face doesn't look the same that you left with. This is not the face you went with. And he comes back and says, whatever this man has to say will become an enormous event. Whatever this man has to say will become an enormous event. Now this is important, because the ayat of Quran, the ayat that the messenger was reciting, we don't have time to go into all of them, but at least the last one. فَإِنْ أَعْرَضُوا This is towards the end of the passage. فَإِنْ أَعْرَضُوا And if they continue to ignore deliberately, if they've done so, فَقُلْ Then you tell them. Now who's you? Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. By the words, Utbah realizes he's not talking to Muhammad, rather Allah is not dignifying Utbah, Allah is telling the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم to tell him. Allah is not telling him directly. Allah could have said, أَنذَرْتُكُمْ I'm warning you. But he said, فَقُلْ أَنذَرْتُكُمْ You tell him that I am warning all of you. All of you of what? صَاعِقَةً A powerful explosion. مِثْلَ صَاعِقَةِ عَادٍ وَثَمُودٍ Just like the explosions that occurred with who? Ad and Thamud. This is something the Arabs knew. They knew this had happened in the past. And now Utbah sitting there just realized he has been issued a direct threat from Allah himself. From the words of the messenger that have been given to him by Allah himself. He was overpowered. He comes back and says, whatever this man has to say, I suggest you take it seriously or it's going to become sayakunu naba'an azima, he says. It's soon going to become a huge event. They say to him, Saharak, he did magic on you too. He cast his spells on you too. He said, say what you will, it's not magic, but I'm not talking to him anymore. He gave up on the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I shared this with you for one reason. To illustrate a tragedy. And that tragedy is the disbelievers at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the believers shared one thing. They shared one thing. They were both overpowered by what? The Quran. They were both overpowered by the Quran. But the believers, on the other hand, the believers of our times, not to mention the disbelievers, even the believers don't appreciate the power of the Quran. They are not stunned, mesmerized, overwhelmed by the words of Allah, even in comparison to the way that the disbelievers used to be mesmerized back then. And that's a tragedy. That's a real tragedy. That effect of the Quran is something that is lost. And it's lost to the point where people can actually make absurd kinds of questions about the Quran, say things about the Quran, how come it says this, how come it says that. It shows that you're not overpowered. I want to give you a visual before I start doing examples, inshallah ta'ala. You see, if you and I were fortunate enough to live in the time of Musa alayhi salam, and we were standing next to him when Allah commanded him to strike the staff and the water started parting. Would you ever question Musa alayhi salam again? Would you ever doubt? Would you ever have any wavering in your faith? I don't think so. That's a pretty heavy duty experience to go through. To watch that happen and for you to escape from the very clutches of death by Allah's miraculous intervention. Our belief as Muslims, as believers in the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that Allah gave him the final, the lasting, and the most powerful of all miracles. Which is what? The Quran. As a result, if we were to appreciate this Quran as a miracle, right now most of us, we appreciate it as a religious text, as a book of guidance, as a book of knowledge. We appreciate those things. But if we add it to our appreciation, its appreciation, its taste as a miracle of Allah, as profound words that are supposed to change lives, just by their impact, their power, then we would have an entirely different sensation of iman. The iman before this and the iman after this is two different things. You see, when the Sahaba heard Quran, they heard two things at the same time. They heard a reminder, advice, guidance, all of that. At the same time, they also experienced a miracle from Allah. When we hear Quran today, at the most, what do we hear? We hear the reminder. What's missing? The miracle. The other side. I want you to visualize that you lived I don't know, thousands of years ago in some society. And when you lived in that society, you had a neighbor. And your neighbor knocked on your door one day and he says to you, an angel came to my house. He told me that I'm the messenger of God and that I'm supposed to deliver this message to all of mankind. I've already delivered it to my family and they've rejected me. And since you're my neighbor, the right of the neighbor is that I tell you, and by the way, I'm a messenger of God and everything I say isn't actually my own words, they're words of who? Of God, of the divine, let's say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, they're words of Allah. And following me actually doesn't mean that you're following me, it means you're obeying Allah. There are two problems with this statement. The neighbor who opens the door and listens to all of this says, wait, so first of all, you're asking me to believe that an angel talked to you? That God speaks to you? You're my neighbor that I've known for 20 years? And this is hard enough to believe, but on top of that, you want me to change everything about my life based on every word you say? Two things that are very hard to do. One, to believe that, especially when your own family says you're what? You're crazy. Your own family says you're crazy and you want me to believe you. And I'm not only should I believe what you're saying, I should follow you in everything that you do. And as the more I follow you, the more people not just call you crazy, who else are they going to call crazy? They're going to call me crazy. I'll think about it, thanks. Close the door. And I'm giving this to you because the messengers of Islam, the messengers of Allah that were sent to different nations, we know that they give da'wah to their people, but it's not like our da'wah. We have it easy. We're in the millions. We're in the millions. It's easy. When you're the only one who believes something in an entire city, you know what you are? You're crazy. What did the people call the messengers? Have you ever read? What did they call them? Insane. They called them insane. You say, oh, those evil people, they call them crazy, they call them insane. How could they do that? Put yourself in their shoes. How easy is it to accept if no one around you believes? If no one around you, everybody around you is a skeptic. No one believes. This is a very, very difficult thing to believe. It's not easy. The Sahaba are the best of people, the best generation for a reason. Their iman was the hardest bridge to cross. When someone takes the Shahada today, it's way easier than the bridge they had to cross. Much, much more difficult. And the hardest of all is the work of the Messenger himself. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because you know, Allah chose the most intelligent people on the face of this earth to be His messengers. They're the most intelligent people and they're smart enough to know that when they go around knocking doors and telling people that they get revelation from God, what should they anticipate practically? They should anticipate that people are going to say that they're insane. They're going to lose their credibility. People are going to laugh at them, even hurt them, even be annoyed with them. They'll lose the touch with their families. That's all going to happen. A smart person can figure that out for himself. They knew this going into this message, but they didn't have a choice because they didn't take this up as a hobby. This was given to them as a responsibility. They had no choice in the matter. Put in this impossible position, these messengers, alayhim as-salatu was-salam, and to help them, and only to help them deliver this message, Allah would give these messengers something that would make their claim more believable. What was that thing? The miracle. Put in this impossible position, these messengers, alayhim as-salatu was-salam, and to help them, and only to help them deliver this message, Allah would give these messengers something that would make their claim more believable. What was that thing? The miracles. Allah would give His messengers miracles so that the skeptics would be quiet, silenced. So the reason for not believing Him is not that they didn't see any proof. The reason is I'm too arrogant to follow Him. That's the only reason left. The reason isn't intellectual anymore. That's the only reason left. And how do you eliminate the first reason, the intellectual problem? You eliminate it by giving the people something that can only be from Allah. It can't be from a human being. It can't be the product of the human mind. It can't be creation. It has to be something beyond. It can't be something that can just occur naturally. You see? Which is why when we read about the miracles of different prophets, the blind person being able to see again, the dead coming back to life, the clay bird turning into a living bird, all of these things are clear signs that this man is not talking on his own behalf, he's speaking on behalf of Allah Azza wa Jalla. But Allah gave this nation the ultimate miracle of all. He gave this nation, this Muslim ummah, and for the rest of mankind, He gave them Qur'an. The staunch difference between Quran and all the other miracles is what? All the other miracles were for the eyes to see. You could see a dead guy come back to life. You could see it. You could see the body of water parting. You could see that. But the Quran was not for the eyes. The Quran was for what? You see something, it penetrates your heart. That's what the previous messengers. With the Quran, إِنَّا سَمِعْنَا قُرْآنًا عَجَبًا فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. What is Allah saying? Listen. Listen to it. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ ضُرِبَ مَثَلٌ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ. Listen to it carefully. Listen to this Quran. It's a miracle for the ears. It's different. All the other miracles were for what? The eyes. This when I was explaining this to my fifth grade classroom back in the day, one of my students, I repeat this often, he said, "Aw, man." I said, "What happened?" He said, "It's not fair, Brother Numan." I was like, "What's not fair?" He said, "All those other prophets got such cool stuff. We just got a book." I know it sounds blasphemous, but he's got a point. It is different. We do claim that a book sitting on the shelf in the masjid is the ultimate miracle of God, the ultimate miracle of Quran, of Islam, the proof of Islam, sitting on each bookshelf, this mushaf. So there has to be some basis that has to be explored. On what basis do we make this claim? And why, subhanahu wa ta'ala, he changed the direction of the miracles. He didn't make it something for the eyes to see. When people saw the water parting, they told their children about it. I saw it with my own eyes, the kids are listening. Then their kids told their kids, and their kids told their kids, until it passed down to us, and we tell our kids at Sunday school, "Hey, by the way, Musa alayhi salam, what did he do?" "Oh, he passed the water, yeah, something about water, yeah." It's just a story now. For the people who were there, was it just a story? No, it was a miracle. But for the people after them, it's just a matter of faith. It's not a miracle to them. It's a matter of faith, but not of a miracle. Because a miracle is something you could see, something you can experience, something you could taste. So now the atheist comes, the disbeliever comes to the Christian or to the Jew, and he says to him, "You believe Jesus turned, you know, the dead guy back to life, or, you know, the bird came back to life, things like that. You believe that?" He says, "Yes." He said, "Why?" "Because the Bible says so." He says, "Were you there when it happened? Did anybody record it? Is it on YouTube? Why do you believe it?" What does the Christian say? "It's in my heart." That's all he has to say. The same atheist, the same kafir, the same disbeliever comes to the Muslims. "You believe the Quran is the word of God?" "Yeah." "Oh yeah? So did you see the angel come down?" "No, no, I didn't." "So how do you know that it's the word of God?" "Well, let's come study the Quran. Let me show you. Let me show you. Let me show you why this can't be human." That next part where I say, "Let me show you," that's what we need to know. We need that part. For ourselves and for others. We really need it for ourselves, because there's no boost in Iman like the boost you get when you experience a miracle of Allah. There's nothing like it. And we need that to be able to illustrate it to others, because then the question will probe them. They won't go to sleep at night. "Man, I didn't come up with an answer to that guy. I gotta look this up." I have a friend who was an atheist who would go around MSA programs all over the country just to mess with the speakers. Right? And he would go and ask them questions, and until he came to one sheikh, and he gave him a miracle of Quran. And he said, "Oh yeah, well, I'll do my research." And he did his research, and he did his research, and he did his research. He couldn't find anything until he had to give up, literally give up, and he took the shahada. And he says, "When I say I'm Muslim," you know what Muslim means, what, right? The one who submits? He said, "I literally submitted. I gave up. I couldn't fight anymore." Said, I didn't have anywhere else to go. SubhanAllah. That is the thing that we need to revive. That is something that we need to appreciate. I'll just give you one example. One example of the Quran as a profound miracle. From the literary point of view. Now you guys have taken literature classes, right? You've taken Shakespeare, you've taken, you know, the Plato's Republic, you've read the Odyssey, right? You've read all this stuff. I won't call it garbage. Everything has some benefit, but whatever. You've read this stuff. These are the landmarks of world literature, the products, the ultimate products of the human mind, right? Our belief is that the Quran is the ultimate literature. Compared to any language, the Quran is the ultimate literature. But that's a subjective thing. If you're literature students, I think this is a science school, but literature is not objective, it is what? It's subjective. So you say it's beautiful, I say it's ugly, right? You like that poem, I don't like that poem. You like this song, I don't like that song. Don't listen to songs, but I'm saying. Okay? Or you like this painting, I don't like that painting. It's subjective. So you could argue that literature is what? It's subjective. But I began by saying Allah says that the Quran is balagh. It is a means of communication. And the point, the purpose of communication is to influence the audience. So we will judge what is better literature by what? What's the measuring stick? What influence does it have? What impact does it have on the world? What change does it cause? How does it change people? How does it influence behavior? How does it modify people's behavior? How does it command over people? That will be the judge. That's a practical judge of the power of any speech, any literature. You could say it's wonderful, but I think it's just fiction. Or you could say it's wonderful and it's changed my life, the way I live. And if you study this fact historically, no society went through a transformation based on a single text, the way in which the Muslims went through with what? With the Quran. No society in human civilization. Never. And in how many years did that society get transformed? 23 years. This is even Orientalists agree. Okay, the Quran is being claimed as revelation. I won't say it is revelation from the kafir's point of view. We know it's revelation. He says it's being claimed as revelation at his age of 40, and it stops at the age of what? 63, 23 years. In 23 years, this man starts at single-handedly, one person. And by the end of these 23 years, what change have these words and this man, this speaker, this speech, and this style of speech, what have they influenced? You see, the way people eat, did it change? The way people sleep, did that change? Did the way people deal with their family change? Did the way people schedule their day change? Did the way people speak to each other change? Did the way they do business change? Did the way they go to the bathroom change? Did the way they dress change? The question isn't what changed. You know what the question is? What didn't change? Everything changed. Everything changed. Whenever there's quote-unquote revolution in society, it's either economic or it's political, right? There's a political change. There's an economic change. There's a military change. But the way people live on a day-to-day basis, that doesn't change. They don't change the way they deal with their families depending on the government changing or a new system coming into power. That's still the same. They're still the same person. But this change that the Quran brought, unparalleled in human history, what exactly changed wasn't just societal, wasn't just on the macro level, it even changed the way people think. Changed everything. Everything. From the very individual level to the collective level. Every spectrum in between. This in itself is an evidence of the unparalleled power of the Quran. The unparalleled power of the Quran. It's unparalleled in this way. Inshallah ta'ala, after the break, all I'm going to talk to you about is just examples from the Quran, one after another, of different aspects of the Quran as literature. We take a break now. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu. The Quran is incredible literature. Incredible literature from many, many different angles. You could study this subject from many different points of view. Actually, I'm working on a seminar that's launching in February dedicated to each angle, each perspective from which we can study and appreciate the eloquence and the precision and beauty of the Quran. I'm only going to present probably three dimensions to you today of the 20 or so that I've compiled thus far. At least three dimensions what I'll try to present to you today, inshallah. And the first of them is precision in word choice or accurate word choice. When you and I speak, we put words together, but we don't necessarily give too much thought to each and every word we say. The central, focus when we communicate isn't the words, it's the actual idea. When you sit down and write something though, then what do? You write something and you say, no, I want to edit it, I want to say it better. And you go back and you change a word or two, or you reorganize your sentence, right? So writing is way more careful than what? And speaking. Speaking is spontaneous, it's on the spot, there's no time to edit your words, it just comes out. But writing is very well thought out. Because there's an editorial process. Now, We already said that the disbeliever says that the Quran is the speech of Muhammad, while the believer knows that it's the speech of Allah. The speech of a human being is not necessarily calculated down to the word. It's not calculated down to the word. But the speech of Allah is perfect, because it comes from a source that is perfect. And that is illustrated with hundreds of thousands of examples in the Quran. This is a subject in and of itself, precision of words in the Quran. It's a subject in and of itself. I'll give you some very brief examples. Shu'aib alayhi salam, you know he's a messenger, right? Okay. Now as a messenger alayhi salam, he is mentioned numerous times in the Quran. Allah Azza wa Jalla says to us, وَإِلَىٰ مَدْيَنَا أَخَاهُمْ شُعَيْبًا. To Madian we sent their brother, Shu'aib. We sent their brother, Shu'aib. Now what I want to tell you is, what is the name of the nation to which he belonged? Madian. Now Madian is the name of two things at the same time. You got to remember this, okay? Madian is two things. Madian is the name of a place, and it's the name of a people. The people are called Madian, and the place is also called Madian. And Allah says, to Madian we sent their brother, Shu'aib. In Surah Al-Shu'ara, Surah number 26, Allah Azza wa Jal gives us the stories of different prophets. He says, إِذْ قَالَ لَهُمْ أَخُوهُمْ لُوطٌ إِذْ قَالَ لَهُمْ أَخُوهُمْ صَالِحٌ إِذْ قَالَ لَهُمْ أَخُوهُمْ هُودٌ إِذْ قَالَ لَهُمْ أَخُوهُمْ نُوحٌ. When their brother Nuh said to them, said to his nation. The next story goes to another prophet. When their brother Salih said to them, to his own nation. Then it goes to Hud. When their brother Hud said to them. Then when their brother Salih, Nuh, Hud, alayhi salam, and Lut, four of them. Their brother. The fifth one mentioned is Shu'aib. Allah says when Shu'aib said to them. He just says, إِذْ قَالَ لَهُمْ شُعَيْبٌ. When Shu'aib says to them. With all the other prophets in that very surah, what did he say? Their brother Nuh, their brother Salih, their brother Lut, their brother Hud. But when it came to Shu'aib, he said, Shu'aib, no brother. What's really interesting is other places in the Quran, Allah says, وَإِلَىٰ مَدْيَنَا, like I told you, وَإِلَىٰ مَدْيَنَا أَخَاهُمْ شُعَيْبًا. To Madian especially, we sent their brother Shu'aib. In the surah in which everybody was declared the brother of their nation, you would expect that when Shu'aib's turn comes, what are you going to see? Their brother. But the word brother is taken out. It's the only one that's been taken out. Everybody else retained. And what we find that's really interesting is right before, remember the nation to which he was sent, what was their name? Madian. They have another name called Ashabul Aika. It's a longer name. Ashabul Aika means the people of Al-Aika. Aika was a giant tree that they used to worship. The name of that tree was Aika. So they were known by their religious name too. Their religious identity was the people of Aika. The fact that he was born in Madian, that he belonged to the city of Madian, that his race was a Midian race, right? One of the Arabs. Because of that, by race and by region, he is their brother. So Allah says, to Madian, we sent their brother, Shu'aib. But when it comes, when Allah mentions them, not as the people of Madian, but the people of what? Al-Aika, that tree. Allah is speaking to them with their religious identity. And when it comes to their religion, is he their brother? No. So when Allah mentions their religion, he says, when Shu'aib said to them, no brother. By removing the brother from that context in particular, what has been highlighted? What's been highlighted is, there is no brotherhood when it comes to conflict in deen. That goes away. It's very, very profound, precise usage. Because what we are told to expect, case after case after case in Surah Al-Shu'ara is, أَخَاهُمْ, أَخُوهُمْ, 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 and all of a sudden the omission of أَخُوهُمْ, precision. And you could see why that precision took place. This is the first small example. Let's look at another example. You know that both the names you see on the screen, Yathrib and Medina, are they names of the same city? Sure. The Quran speaks about the city of Medina with the word Medina many times. At least four citations I put on the screen for you. But it only uses Yathrib once. Yathrib is used only in Surah Al-Ahzab. That's it. There's no other place where Yathrib is used in the Quran. By the way, both are names of Medina. So you could argue from the devil's advocate point of view, hey, they mean the same thing, right? So why don't I just change Yathrib to what? Medina. Or why don't I change Medina to Yathrib? You guys keep talking about Quran is perfect, intricate word choice. You guys know too that Yathrib and Medina is the same thing. So why not put one in the other's place? What's the big deal? What difference does it make? This is a study more so of history. Before the Prophet arrived, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in Medina, what was its name? Yathrib. After he came to the city, he was unanimously declared the leader of that city, and the city was coined Madinatun Nabi, the city of the Prophet. For short, the city. Medina is short for what? The city of the Prophet. Because literally Medina means what? The city. So Medina's nickname is Medina, actually. That's the nickname. The actual name is Yathrib. Or you could think of it like this. Before the Prophet came, it was Yathrib. After he came, it is Medina. But what's interesting is Surah Al-Ahzab, Surah number 33, actually uses Medina and uses Yathrib, same surah. And what's interesting on top of that is Surah Al-Ahzab is a Madani surah. What do you know about Madani surahs? Where was the Prophet in Madani surahs? He was in Medina. So already the city should have been called what? Medina, but we see the word Yathrib. You see the riddle here? Right? Now here's the thing. Medina was short for Madinatun Nabi, city of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When Medina was surrounded by enemy forces, some Jewish tribes got together, they came and they convinced the Quraysh to come back and rally after the loss of Uhud. They went around and made alliances with smaller tribes and turned it into a massive army that surrounded the entire city of Medina. The city of Medina was being held hostage for weeks on end. This scary situation was even worsened because people on the inside, there were people on the inside that were Muslims, but some of them were only Muslim by name, and actually there wasn't really iman in their hearts. What's that group called? The munafiqun, the hypocrites, right? Now, some of these hypocrites, before the Prophet came, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were the leaders of what city? They were the leaders of Yathrib. When the Prophet came, they had to give up their positions. They had to give up their leadership, because now who's the leader? By default, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When they were surrounded, they saw it as an opportunity to rally the forces and say, look what his leadership got us into. Right? So they say, وَقَالُوا يَا أَهْلَ يَثْرِبْ لَا مُقَامَ لَكُمْ. They said, O people of Yathrib, there's no place left for you. فَرْجِعُوا, let's go back. Go back to what? Let's go back to making it Yathrib again. Let's go back to the way things were before the Prophet ﷺ had leadership. By using the word Yathrib, you know what they exposed? Their true allegiance. Because if they acknowledged the messenger as their leader, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what word would they have used? Medina. So just by using that word, Allah caught their word, exposed it in the Quran, and what we learn from that is their allegiances, their aspirations were, oh, one day it'll be back to Yathrib again. It won't be Medina anymore. This becomes even more evident, more clearer, when we go to other places. Surah Al-Munafiqun, the surah dedicated to who? The hypocrites. Now the surah dedicated to the hypocrites is interesting. It begins with the hypocrites going out of their way to show allegiance to the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They go out of their way to show allegiance to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. إِذَا جَاءَكَ الْمُنَافِقُونَ قَالُوا نَشْهَدُ إِنَّكَ لَرَسُولُ اللَّهِ. When the hypocrites come to you, whenever they come to you, they say, oh, we bear witness. No doubt you are certainly the messenger of Allah. Now the Muslim doesn't have to say that to the messenger every time. Only when he converts. Right? When he accepts it, then he says it. Otherwise he knows he's the messenger of Allah. But if you're trying to compensate for something you're feeling on the inside, like a child who says, I didn't do it, by the way. And you say, what did you not do? Right? Is it a guilty conscience that speaks? It's the guilty conscience that makes them say, we really believe you're the messenger of Allah. And in that surah, to show their allegiance on the outside, they said, لَإِن رَجَعْنَا إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ لَيُخْرِجَنَّ الْأَعَزُّ مِنْهَا الْأَذَلِ. Right? They said when we return to Medina, because they were trying to show their allegiance. But when it came to desperate times in Surah Al-Ahzab, the wrong word came out of their mouth. And their true allegiances were exposed. Another interesting comparison, Mecca and Bakka. Have you heard these two names of Mecca before? They both occur once in the Quran. Once in the Quran, in Surah Muhammad, Allah Azza wa Jal uses the word Mecca. Another time he uses the word Bakka. Now historically speaking, they are both names of the same city, Mecca. Some have argued that Bakka was the first name and Mecca is the later name. More accurately though, linguists have argued that Mecca is the name and Bakka is the nickname. Mecca is the name and Bakka is the nickname. It comes from Bakk, which is an Arabic verb. It means to be crowded. It means to have lots of crowd and, you know, congestion of traffic. Okay? Al-izdiham in modern Arabic we use. Okay? Now, when Bakka is used in Surah Ali Imran with a ba, originating from the word crowd, the very few ayat that follow are ayat of Hajj. وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ. What comes with Hajj? Crowd. So what's the better word in that context? Bakka. But when there's no mention of Hajj in Surah Muhammad, you go back to normal and what word do you use? Mecca. SubhanAllah. Even this small detail, you and I would say Mecca, Bakka, same thing. Interchangeable. They're the same word. But the level of precision in the Quran's words is unparalleled. Human beings can't think at that level when they speak. They can't think at that level. We're not at that level of accuracy. So one thing we learn from Quran is how careful we need to be with our tongues. Right? This is the sunnah of Allah Azza wa Jal. He speaks in very, very, very precise, even to the minutest detail. Another interesting comparison, we go back to Surah Al-Ahzab. Accuracy. So one thing we learn from Quran is how careful we need to be with our tongues. Right? This is the sunnah of Allah Azza wa Jal. He speaks in very, very, very precise, even to the minutest detail. Another interesting comparison, we go back to Surah Al-Ahzab. This you may have heard before. مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ مِنْ قَلْبَيْنِ فِي جَوْفِهِ. In the fourth ayah, Allah says, Allah did not put two hearts inside of any man whatsoever. Huh. But now listen carefully. وَمَا جَعَلَ أَزْوَاجُكُمْ. You know what azwaj means? Spouses. Spouses. And Allah is speaking to men from the beginning of the ayah, so it means wives. Because the beginning of the ayah is talking to men, spouses here means wives. Wives are women. وَمَا جَعَلَ أَزْوَاجُكُمْ أَلَّا تُظَاهِرُونَ مِنْهُنَّ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ. You know what أُمَّهَات means? Mothers. Women, right? The rest of the ayah is dealing with women. But the beginning of the ayah, Allah says, Allah did not put two hearts inside of any man. مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِي رَجُلٍ. The ayah has men and women both in it. So I would guess we could say, Allah did not put two hearts inside of any human being. Because if you say human being, who does it include? Men and women, both. But if you say man, it only includes man. This is so because the Quran is literally accurate and figuratively accurate. Of course, when Allah says Allah didn't put two hearts inside of any man, He's not being literal. The idea is two intentions at the same time. Iman and kufr at the same time. Right? Iman and nifaq at the same time. Hypocrisy and faith can't coexist. One or the other. Faith or belief or disbelief, they can't coexist, one or the other. Certainty and doubt can't coexist, one or the other. So the figurative expression is, Allah did not put two hearts inside of any man. But if you take it literally, is it true literally too? Right. But for women, they can get pregnant. And when they get pregnant, how many hearts can be inside them? SubhanAllah. You could have argued literally, hey, what about women? They might have two hearts at some point. But even that criticism from the literal point of view isn't even possible. مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ مِنْ قَلْبَيْنِ فِي جَوْفِي. SubhanAllah. Okay. Another one. I didn't put Arabic on the screen on purpose, because I don't want you to think that you can appreciate this subject only by Arabic. I really want to water this down to English, inshallah ta'ala, as much as possible. Allah speaks about tranquility often. The Arabic word for tranquility is as-sakina. As-sakina. Allah Azza wa Jal says, هو الذي أنزل السكينة في قلوب المؤمنين. He is the one who sent tranquility into the hearts of the believers. He sent it into the hearts of the believers. But then several times in Surah Al-Fath and Surah Al-Tawbah also, فأنزل سكينته على رسوله وعلى المؤمنين هو الذي أنزل actually فعلم ما في قلوبهم فأنزل السكينة عليهم. He sent tranquility upon them. In one place he says in the same surah he sent tranquility inside their hearts. In another he says he sent tranquility upon them. Now, tranquility inside your hearts, tranquility upon you, it's the same idea essentially, but not close enough. This would be undermining the precision of the Qur'an. You see, the hearts, basically in the Qur'an, Allah speaks of two negative sentiments. There are many, but two central negative sentiments in the hearts. لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. There's fear in the heart, and there's grief in the heart. Of the negative emotions that you have, they stem from one of two things. Either they stem from fear, or they stem from grief. These are the two main negative. Anger can result from grief and go get worse, right? And fear leads to many other diseases, like hypocrisy can be a source, the source of it can be fear. So now these two feelings are in Arabic literature, in poetry even before Islam, the anger is described as something that rages inside your heart. And it's something that doesn't go away, it stays. Like if you're mad at your friend for saying something to you, you're not just mad at them at that time when they said it to you, you're mad at them every time you see their face. It's in your heart. It didn't just overcome you at that time, it got installed. So you have to uninstall. Which means you have to go where? Inside the heart. The beginning of Surah Al-Fath. The Muslims have traveled all the way from Medina to go make Hajj. Did they get to make Hajj at Hudaybiyah? No. So what's in the hearts? Anger, frustration. We came all this way. If you study the seerah, you'll find a lot of frustration on even the tongues of the believers. Right? So where was the tranquility needed? Inside the hearts. Inside the hearts. But fear, and even in Arabic imagery, you find this in shi'r, fear is something felt on the skin. Fear is something felt in your entire body, it shivers. Fear is something that overwhelms, it comes over your heart. Instead of in your heart, it is over your heart, and it doesn't linger. When it's inside your heart, it doesn't get out until you go in and get it out. But when it's over your heart, as soon as the scary situation's over, what happens? You're back to normal. Your kids are playing around, there's almost all of a sudden there's thunder. Kids get scared. Thunder's over, they get back to playing again. Right? That's how we are. You hear something scary or you're in a scary situation, as soon as that situation is over, you're back to normal. The fear doesn't come back necessarily. But with anger, you don't have to be, somebody doesn't have to upset you for you to be angry again. It's the old anger that can come back for no other reason. You understand? So now since the anger or the fear overcomes you, what has to overcome you to counter it? Tranquility. So Allah, in the situations wherever sakina is mentioned with ala, tranquility sent down upon, like when the Messenger ﷺ was in the cave with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, and the investigators were looking for them, trying to find them and kill them, this was a situation of anger or fear? This was a situation of fear. So Allah sent tranquility upon them, alayhim. When the kuffar at the end of Surah Al-Fath, you know, they had gotten together, hamiyat al-jahiliyyah, they got together in this gang mentality to gang up against the Muslims and go fight them. This was an intimidating situation because the Muslims were barely armed. Allah sent tranquility upon them. When Allah Azza wa Jal promised that they will enter the city of Mecca peacefully, لَتَدْخُلُنَّ الْمَسْجِدَ الْحَرَامِ إِنْشَاءَ اللَّهُ آمِنِينَ. You will enter it peacefully. Because if you enter it peacefully, and by the way, لَا تَخَافُونَ. You're not going to be afraid of anything. Denying the fear. And in that situation, He sent tranquility upon them. Upon them. So there's tranquility inside and there's tranquility upon. If you just read it casually, you'll say, hey, it's the same thing. But if you appreciate the profound accuracy of words, down to the preposition from into upon. That's just prepositions. Even that is incredibly accurate. This is one of my favorites. The next one. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ. How does the ayah go? لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. Many people know that ayah, right? Now, what does ذَلِكَ mean? Anybody know? That. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ. That book. That book. Now, when I say this, as opposed to saying that, which one is closer? Is this book closer or that book closer? This book is closer. This book is closer. That book is far away. Because that, a pointing word, ذَلِكَ, is for distance. But when something is closer, you don't say that, you say this. What's interesting in the Quran is, we find that book, but for the most part, multiple instances of not saying that Quran, but this Quran, هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ. This Quran. So when Allah uses book, of course He's talking about the Quran, right? But He puts it far away. When He talks about Quran, what does He do? Close. We'll come to the third one last, but at least for now, the comparison of the top two, that book versus this Quran. You see, the word book in Arabic is kitab, the origin of which is kataba yaktubu, to write. It comes from to write. The actual meaning of kitab is that which is documented, that which is etched or written. Now, where is the Quran written? Where is it written? Was it already written when it was being revealed? Huh? No. In its complete form, was it already in existence with who? So the actual book is where? Near or far? So it's appropriate to say that book, because that's where it's written. The word book in Arabic has to do with writing. Now the word Qur'an comes from qara'a yaqra'u. One of the origins of Qur'an is qara'a yaqra'u, to recite, to read. Where is the reading taking place? Over here. So what's more appropriate? This recital. SubhanAllah. And then in one instance Allah says, هَذَا كِتَابٌ. This is a book. So you say, aha, the theory is broken. Because now book is being used with what word? This. Close. But He adds, هَذَا كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ. We sent it down. This is a book that we sent down. So even when He used this, He added, it didn't come from here, it's from there. Because the implied, you know, what can be alluded when you say this, is that the origin is here. You can stretch the meaning further and say, oh, you said this book, meaning you wrote it here somewhere. So now Allah Azza wa Jal prevents that possible thought from even occurring by saying, that book, versus this Qur'an, هذا القرآن. We don't see that Qur'an, we see this Qur'an in the book, subhanAllah. Another stellar example, inshaAllah ta'ala. The two ayat are Baqarah and Surah Ibrahim. Another stellar example, inshaAllah ta'ala. The two ayat are Baqarah and Surah Ibrahim. This is the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا بَلَدًا آمِنًا in Surah Al-Baqarah. My Lord, make this a peaceful city. My Lord, make this a peaceful city. رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا. Lord, make this city peaceful. Now the English is very similar to the Arabic here as far as the meaning. Make this a peaceful city versus what? Make this city peaceful. You would think it's the same dua almost. Even in the Arabic, there's a difference just of an alif lam. هَذَا بَلَدًا آمِنًا and هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا. Small difference. But actually, before Mecca was a city, because the city is what? Mecca, right? Everybody knows that? Before Mecca was a city, He made a dua to turn it into a city and to turn it into a peaceful city. So the first dua, رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا بَلَدًا آمِنًا, is when He had not even seen the city turn into a city yet. And the dua was to turn it into a city that happens to be peaceful. When He came back alayhi salam to the city, and it was already a city, He modified His dua and said what? Make this city, which already exists, make it peaceful, safe. SubhanAllah. It's very precise wording. Now, on top of this, I want to share with you what is the further component. What are the further components of this dua? رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا بَلَدًا آمِنًا. Make this a peaceful city. What are the requirements of peace in a city? Is peace the only thing you look for in a city? No. If there are no jobs, you can't stay there. If you can't make any money and there's lots of police protection, the society is going to fall apart anyway because people can't survive. So in the first dua, he made a complete dua for an establishment of a healthy, sustainable city. He said, رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا بَلَدًا آمِنًا وَارْزُقْ أَهْلَهُ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ. Provide its citizens from all kinds of fruit. Make sure that they're taken care of, they have provisions. So he made dua for the peace of a city and the prosperity of that city. You know the English expression, peace and prosperity? Right? In political science 101, you're going to learn that if you have peace and no prosperity, the society falls. And if you have prosperity and no peace, the society falls. What do you need for a society to sustain itself? Peace and prosperity. This is why at the end of Quran you find Surah Quraysh, لِإِلَافِ Quraysh, right? That's a surah about the prosperity of the city. Then we have أَلَمْ تَرَى كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ. Surah Al-Fil is about what? The prosperity of the city or the safety of the city? The safety of the city. They go hand in hand. One surah dedicated to its prosperity, the other dedicated to its peace. You need both these things. So when he made dua that his city come into being, he made dua of these two things. مَنْ آمَنَ مِنْهُمْ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Whoever believes in Allah in the last day, provide them with all kinds of fruits. I won't go further into his dua there. But if you come to the bottom one, was it already a city now? Yeah, it was already being provided for. That was taken care of. He didn't want to ask for that again because it was already there. So he asked for something else. وَاجْنُبْنِي وَبَنِيَّ أَنْ نَعْبُدَ الْأَصْنَامِ. Protect me and my children. Prevent us that we may end up falling into the worship of idols. Prevent us from falling into the worship of idols. Because now when a city is peaceful and it's safe, necessarily what might happen is corruption. When life is good, you tend to party. And the worst kind of partying that shaitan will get you into is what? Shirk. Shirk. He sees this, the farsightedness of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So when he came back to the city, his dua was, don't let this be a place of idol worship. Prevent me and my children from worshipping idols. Subhanallah. Alayhi salam, the genius of that man. The next case. The Arabic word imra'a. Imra'a. In isolation, it means woman. But as a mudaf, and those of you that know Arabic know what a mudaf is, those of you that don't, shame on you. No, I'm kidding. Learn Arabic, inshallah, it's easy. Yes, before, very good. Somebody was paying attention in my class. So, the mudaf, when it curses mudaf, it means wife. Wife. Imra'a. Another word for wife that's used in the Quran is actually more appropriate for spouse, zawj. Zawj. Both words are used. Now we find imra'ata Nuhin, the wife of Nuh. Imra'ata Lutin, the wife of who? Lut. وَامْرَأَتُهُ حَمَّالَةَ الْحَطَبِ. What do you think? Whose wife is that? Abu Lahab. You guys know that, right? تَبَّتْ يَدَا أَبِي لَهَبٍ وَتَبْ. In that surah we find وَامْرَأَتُهُ, his wife. His wife. So far we have the wife of Nuh. Good woman or bad woman? She's not good, no. She's a pretty bad lady. Wife of Lut? Bad. Wife of Abu Lahab? Terrible, yeah, pretty bad. Then, Imra'atuhu for Imra'at Zakariya. Allah Azza wa Jal sends an angel to Zakariya, says, you're going to have a son, and he says, أَنَّا يَكُونُ لِي وَلَدْ وَكَانَتْ إِمْرَأَتِي أَنَّا يَكُونُ لِي غُلَامْ وَكَانَتْ إِمْرَأَتِي عَاقِرًا. إِمْرَأَتِي. His wife, good or bad? Great. Imra'ah is used for women that aren't very good and also used for women that are good. So we can't say that Imra'ah is used only for bad women. By the way, Imra'at al-Aziz, the wife of the minister in Surah Yusuf. Good lady, bad lady, bad person. The wife of Fir'aun, Imra'at al-Fir'aun, one of the best. So we can't decisively say that when Imra'ah is used, it's only used for bad people. Or we can't say the other way, that it's only used for good people either, right? But then what I want to share with you is the word zawj or zawaj, it comes from zawaj, pairing. Literally, the word means pairing. What's the purpose of a pair? A pair is two parts of one thing that go together to make something greater. The night and the day are paired, and together they make the whole day, right? The sun and the moon are paired, right? They're pairs. Now, similarly, man and woman are also a pair. What is the purpose of the pairing of a man and a woman? What's the purpose? There are two functions mainly. The first function is the increase of good in a society. When people get married, two people get married, two less people prone to fitna at the next convention. Right? So, I'm kidding. Not you. Okay. So two less people prone to fitna. Two more families coming together. It's necessarily, whenever two people get married, it is an increase of goodness and a reduction in evil. But that goodness can only happen when the husband and wife get along. And they're both, the goals together are for goodness. Right? The second purpose of marriage is human beings won't survive unless we have children. There are only two ways to have children. The legitimate way or the illegitimate way. So the second function of marriage is obviously what? The legitimate, the appropriate way of having children. So two functions of marriage, goodness and children. This is the basic functionality of marriage. If any of these are missing, they're not called a pair in the Quran. Zawj is not used. If either of these are missing, zawj is not used. Let's go revisit these words. The wife of Nuh, was something missing? No good was coming out of that marriage. The wife of Lut, was something missing? Goodness. The wife of Abu Lahab, two negatives don't make a positive. Right? So, this is a pretty bad relationship. Even though they were very compatible. Okay? Now, the wife of Zachariah, angel comes and says, you're going to have a boy. She says, I can't. What's missing? Children are missing. Imra'ah. The wife of Ibrahim, before the child came, Imra'atuhu, his wife heard it, the news of a boy, and she started laughing. Right? So before the child, Imra'ah. Then we find the wife of the minister, Imra'ah. The wife of Fir'aun, great lady, what's missing? Goodness in the marriage. Compatibility between the husband and wife. And of course, children. The issue of children too. Now, all of this, having said all of this, by the way, the Prophet's wives, our mothers, radiallahu anhunna, all of them together are called azwaj. Because we don't separate them. We look at all of them as one. So what's the appropriate term for them? Zawj. Okay, zawj or azwaj. Now, the interesting case happens with Zachariah alayhi salam. Did Zachariah, you know what happens? Allah Azza wa Jal granted him a son. What's his son's name? Yahya alayhi salam. Allah says, وَوَهَبْنَا لَهُ يَحْيَا. We granted him Yahya. وَأَصْلَحْنَا لَهُ زَوْجَهُ. And we reconcile for him his zawj. Before the child, Allah mentions his wife as what? Imra'ah. As soon as the ayah mentions that he had a child, the word for his wife used was zawj. Because that which was missing is not missing anymore. Subhanallah. This is going to get a little heavy. I warn you. Andartukum. Okay. You know, there are many surahs in the Quran that have oaths. Allah Azza wa Jal swears by different things. Right? Okay. You know, there are many surahs in the Quran that have oaths. Allah Azza wa Jal swears by different things. Right? And the example I decided to share with you today has to do with Surah Al-Mursalat, Surah number 77. Traditionally, it has been held that the oath that Allah swears by something because it's very important. وَالتِّينِ وَالزَّيْتُونِ وَطُورِ سِينِينَ وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا وَالْعَصْرِ وَالصُّبْحِ وَالْفَجْرِ وَاللَّيْلِ وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ وَالْفَجْرِ. Right? All of these are oaths in the Quran. Allah swears by different things. One of the views that has been held is that Allah swears by these things because in and of themselves they are powerful and sacred or important. But that's not all. Allah swears by different things to allude or to present an argument that is about to come. So if the beginning of a surah has oaths, it is leading to a conclusion which is called Jawab al-Qasam, the response to these oaths. The oaths are there to set a certain mindset, prepare you for an argument that is coming. Okay? With that in mind, I want to share with you some oaths, some really powerful literary oaths in the beginning of Surah Al-Mursalat. By the way, Surah Al-Mursalat belongs to a handful of surahs in the Quran in which there is a lot of repetition. There's a lot of repetition. Okay? This is one of those surahs in which there's a lot of repetition. One of them is Surah Al-Rahman, very famous. فَبِأَيِّ أَلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ فَوَيْلٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ لِلْمُكَذِّبِينَ is the repetition in Surah Al-Mursalat. Another surah with a lot of repetition is Surah Al-Shu'ara. Okay? These are a few handful of surahs in which there's a lot of repetition. Now, the purpose of that repetition is the discussion for another day, inshallah, because it has a profound function. Today we're dealing with the oaths themselves. You see, the Quraysh had argued, you keep talking about the sun and the moon colliding, about the mountains are going to move swiftly like they're made of wool, and they're going to move like that. People are going to be looking drunk. The oceans are going to boil over. These big things, this is not going to happen. All this, when is it going to come? All these big things you talk about, we've never seen anything like that. So they were basically arguing that the challenges and the threats of the Quran are too cataclysmic. They are too enormous to be possible. In response to that, Allah Azza wa Jal takes an oath in these few ayat, by majority opinion of the Mufassirun and from the language it is supported, by winds. Allah swears in the beginning of Surah Al-Mursalat, by the creation of Allah, winds. Al-Mursal, Al-Mursala, is used actually in Arabic for that which has been released. It was used for horses. The word urf, which is wal-mursalati urfa, is the ayah. Urf in Arabic is the back, the horse on the back of its head, its neck, there's this hair. And if you don't have ropes for a horse, what's the only thing you can grab onto to slow it down? It's that hair. Allah Azza wa Jal gives the image of winds as though they are like a horse, a wild horse, who has been unleashed because its hair has been let go. What happens to a horse, a wild horse, when you let go of its hair? Goes crazy. Marches forward, doesn't care where it's going, full speed ahead. So what's being paralleled is the image of a wild horse with winds. Meaning winds that Allah is telling the Quraysh, first of all, that winds are not something that blow randomly this way or that way. This soft breeze you feel on your face is because the reins are being held. By who? By Allah Azza wa Jal. But it is very possible for that same Lord to let go of that lock of hair, and what's going to happen? They're going to turn into this wild horse, the stallion that's going to breeze through, crush through. وَالْمُرْسَلَاتِ عُرْفَ. The first one, the wild horse that has been released, like released, the winds. The second, فَالْعَاصِفَاتِ. عَصْف in Arabic is to move in an inconsiderate fashion. What I mean by that is if I run into this thing and I don't even care it's here and I keep running over it and trample over it, I don't care what's in my way, I keep going. Okay? Like a truck that doesn't have brakes. Just crushes everything in its path, a bulldozer nowadays. The movement of the bulldozer is asf, inconsiderate, doesn't care what's in its way. It's going to go anyway. وَالْعَاصِفَاتِ asfa. These winds, Allah continues the oath, these same winds that have been unleashed, now they've become inconsiderate, merciless. They don't care what comes in the way, they just go. In two ayat, Allah has described winds as a source of destruction. If you guys have ever seen video footage of what happened after Ike, or what happens after a hurricane, or after a tornado, after 40 seconds that it hits a town, 40 seconds, you see what happens to those homes? Right? Allah Azza wa Jal sent winds upon a nation 7 consecutive days. 7 consecutive days, winds have been unleashed upon them. سَخَّرَ عَلَيْهِمْ سَبْعَ لَيَالٍ 7 nights, وَثَمَانِيَةَ أَيَّامٍ حُسُومًا. Subhanallah, 7 nights, 8 days rather. Continuously pounding them. What does 40 seconds do? I saw, after Galveston, after the Hurricane Ike, I saw some footage and I was there a few weeks ago. You know how they have those railings on the beach? Those metal railings that are this thick? They were twisted around like noodles. It's the craziest thing I've ever seen. Subhanallah. Now the winds which is not some major cataclysmic sun and moon coming together. There's no special event that has to be prepared. You know, when you make special arrangements for a mass weapon of destruction, what is Allah using to destroy these people? The wind. Allah doesn't need to make, in two ayat, He's told the Quraysh, there needs to be no special arrangement made for you guys. All He has to do is release the lock on the winds. That's all He has to do. And then He turns around and He goes the other, gives you the other dimension of winds. Winds can be a source of death, yes, but they are actually also a source of mercy. Allah Azza wa Jalla continues the next two oaths, وَالنَّاشِرَاتِ نَشْرَى. And the winds that serve to spread all over, they spread. Nashr literally means you take a bunch of seeds, you throw them on the ground. What happens to the seeds? They spread in random directions, right? So Allah speaks about the winds that carry and disperse. What the ulama of tafsir have concluded from this is that the winds carry and disperse the clouds. Because the clouds, wherever they go, what's going to fall? Rain. And rain is the source of life on this earth. No rain, no life. Drought means death. So the winds that were the source of death in the first two oaths are now beginning to be the source of what? Of life. And now we know even better. Now we know winds don't just carry the clouds around. What else do they carry with them? The pollen. The source of vegetation. Pollen travels from one place to the other by means of winds. Right? Those of you that have bad allergies know that pretty well. It's actually a mercy of Allah. Right? Which is why we're reminded to say Alhamdulillah, right? Subhanallah. Anyway, وَالنَّاشِرَاتِ نَشْرًا. Allah Azza wa Jal spreads these clouds out. Now when you think of clouds spreading or pollen falling, you would think that this is random. You would think that this division of the clouds is going that way, not this way, or the drop fell here, not there. This is random. They call it the random acts of Mother Nature. We know there's no such thing. These are precise, calculated acts of who? Of Allah Azza wa Jal. So He says, فَالْفَارِقَاتِ فَرْقًا. Those who make very precise divisions. It's going to fall here, not here. This land will remain dry, this land will get water. فَالْفَارِقَاتِ فَرْقًا. Two things have been given to us so far. These winds, they bring about rain, they bring about life, and also they bring about what? Death. Both things. Then Allah Azza wa Jal says after this, فَالْمُلْقِيَاتِ ذِكْرًا. They bring people into contact with reminder. These winds bring people into contact with reminder. Just a few reminders that I want to share with you that these winds bring about, if you reflect upon them. Winds are making, they're causing a cooperation between the heavens and the earth. The clouds are moving in the heavens, and the rain is falling on the earth. All of it to serve who? Serve us. Serve the human being. Allah is showing just by means of the winds that He has given, it's a single leadership. It's a single chain of command. It only comes from Allah. They're not under separate leaderships. It shows the purpose of creation. One of the great reminders of the ayat, the purpose of creation. How everything comes and cooperates with everything else. All as a favor to me. Right? Reminds you of your own purpose. If Allah has created all of these things with such purpose, then I, this thing has been created, خَلَقَ لَكُمْ, He created for you, I must have a purpose too. So even wind reminds me of my purpose in life. It's a profound reminder. And then the second reminder that the winds carry, you know, I give you an example. If you left your pet in the house without giving them water, you forgot. You come back after the whole day. Your pet is at whose mercy? At your mercy. Until you take a little plate or, you know, a little, a drop of water and drop it in their tongue, they're begging for it. Whether that animal scratches you or damages your property or listens to you, doesn't listen to you, in the end they submit to who? To you. As wild as they can get. As wild and rebellious as human beings can get. If Allah does not give us these sips of water to drink, where do we go? There's nowhere else. We're more pathetic than the pets we think we own. We are more powerless before Allah. It is a reminder of the lordship of Allah that He's letting you drink these sips. This water is not your product. You can walk about arrogantly on the earth, but if He doesn't send that mercy from the sky, where are you going to be? It's the lordship of Allah. The winds are reminding you of Allah's lordship over you and me. The second powerful reminder, so these winds deliver a reminder. The winds are a reminder of resurrection. These winds come, water comes from the sky, the earth is dead, and what happens to the earth? It comes back to life. Dead becomes living. And now every time the rains bring life to the earth, we are reminded that we will also die and we will also be in this earth, and just like the earth is giving out vegetation, it will be giving out human beings on the day of resurrection. It's a reminder of resurrection. All of that reminder starts where, if you just reflect on what? The wind. Subhanallah. فَالْمُلْقِيَاتِ ذِكْرًا. And then finally, we said the wind does two things. It comes as a source of destruction or as a source of mercy, which reminds us that Allah has in place a profound system of punishment and of reward. Something that begets His wrath and other things that beget His mercy. So we are reminded not to cross certain lines and to pursue certain other things in life. We are reminded of Allah's justice. We are reminded of Allah's commandments just by the winds. And now that Allah has sent these winds and asked you to think about them in this way, and the Arab would process this, he would hear these words and will process them immediately. The last few ayat that I want to share with you, عُذْرًا أَوْ نُذْرًا. عُذْرًا أَوْ نُذْرًا. People, all of us will feel the wind on our face. There'll be two kinds of people. People that will take the reminder and now they are warned, right? What's the other kind of person? Nothing. Nothing, they just pass out, nice breeze. Right? So for the people who took the warning, the winds served as a warner. Nudra. And for the people who didn't care, now the wind is an excuse to punish them. Allah sent them a reminder and they ignored it. Now that wind has become an excuse, a means by which they should be punished. Udhr. A reason, a cause, an excuse that is now in creation that is witness against them. May Allah protect us from that. Udhran aw nudra. And after all these oaths, these are the oaths, these are setting the stage, this is not even the argument yet. This is just preparing you for the argument. What's the actual point? إِنَّمَا تُوْعَدُونَ لَوَاقِعٌ. What you have been promised is no doubt going to become certainty. It is going to happen. You have been promised something, it is bound to occur. Either just like these winds that deliver Allah's mercy or Allah's wrath, you will be the recipient one day of Allah's extreme mercy or Allah's extreme wrath, it is bound to happen. Oaths in the Quran are a profound literary masterpiece in and of themselves. Each one of them. The surahs that begin with oaths demand special, special study, just in and of themselves. Right? And they're not all structured in the same way. It's an intricate study that a lot of our ulama went into. Dialogue in the Quran. I'm going to sound a little blasphemous to you guys, I'm sorry. It's just a thing with being a teacher. You do whatever you can to get the point across. Okay, I'm not much of a speaker, I try to turn more into a teacher or a tutor. Anybody here ever see Finding Nemo? Dialogue in the Quran. I'm going to sound a little blasphemous to you guys, I'm sorry. It's just a thing with being a teacher. You do whatever you can to get the point across. Okay, I'm not much of a speaker, I try to turn more into a teacher or a tutor. Anybody here ever see Finding Nemo? Okay, if you haven't seen it, go see it. It's a great movie, no bad language, and there's only one bad thing in it. The Nemo says, I hate you, to his dad at one line, and pays for it the whole movie. So that's good. Other than that, yeah, usually even children's films have filth in them. So, yeah, so... But anyway, it's a decent movie. Anyway, the reason I brought it up, and it's going to tie into what I'm about to share with you, there's this one scene in the movie that I'd like you to recall. And this one scene... Nemo's dad, what was his name, Marlin? Right? Nemo's dad, yeah, so sisters watch this a lot, yeah. So, Marlin is all depressed, he's sitting on the back of this turtle named Crush, and he's all sad, and these little mini turtles come and say, what happened? And he says, I don't want to talk about it. And then they get him to tell his story, and they all listen very carefully. Right? Now, the way that the movie is filmed, it's animated, Marlin is telling, this fish is telling his story to turtles. But they don't show him tell the entire story. You know what they do? They cut it out, and all of a sudden, those turtles are talking to some other fish. And then those fish are talking to some other fish. And those fish are talking to some birds. And those birds are talking to other birds. And they cut until the story gets to Nemo. But they didn't show it that the whole story was told from A to B, then B narrated the whole story to C, and C narrated the whole story to D. They didn't have to waste time in the repetition. They just transfused from one scene to the other. You know what I'm talking about? Right? Now this is a technique in modern film, right? Where you go from one scene to the next, and you sort of, the audience is expected to know what happened in between the lines. It's self-explanatory that everybody communicated the story further down the line. It's self-explanatory. This is a technique in modern film, but it's actually used a lot in the Quran, transition.
Iltifat. It's used, it's very dominant feature of the Quran. I only brought it to you from Finding Nemo because I hope you've seen Finding Nemo and you know what transition is then. But I want to share an example of alluding to this dialogue, one of my favorite dialogues in the Quran. وَإِذْ نَادَى رَبُّكَ مُوسَى. When your Lord called on Musa, أَنِئْتِ الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. Go to the wrongful nation. Go to the wrongful nation. The Lord called on Musa, go where? The wrongful nation. قَوْمَ فِرْعَوْنَ. Specifically the nation of who? Fir'aun. أَلَا يَتَّقُونَ. Don't they have any taqwa? Don't they have any consciousness of no fear of Allah? Now Musa responds, عليه السلام. قَالَ. He said, رَبِّ إِنِّي أَخَافُ أَن يُكَذِّبُونَ. My Lord, there's no doubt I'm afraid that they're going to lie against me. A few lines down, we will find he is afraid. He says, I'm afraid that they are going to kill me. But the first fear he tells Allah is what? I'm afraid they're going to lie against me. What this tells us is something profound. Musa alayhi salam is not cared about life and death. He's not concerned about life and death. That's not what he cares about. What he cares about is this mission that Allah has given him. He does not want to disappoint this mission that Allah has handed him. And if they lie against him, he will not be able to fulfill his mission. So the first fear he expresses to Allah is that they are going to belie me. They're going to lie against me. They're going to disregard me. إِنِّي أَخَافُ أَن يُكَذِّبُونَ. Something pertaining directly to the task Allah gave him. And then the second problem. وَيَضِيقُ صَدْرِي. My chest becomes tight. Musa alayhi salam was known to have a temper. When people speak to him in obnoxious terms about Allah, like Fir'aun did, when somebody speaks to him clearly in the wrong, the first thing, some people are able to keep their calm and respond. Other people get really, really upset when they hear something outrageous, right? And there's some people in debate, their job is to say things outrageous to make you so angry that you can't think straight. And then you trip on your words. Now, it's not that you don't know what you're talking about, but you're just so mad that you can't talk clearly anymore. And he says he has that problem. He says, وَيَضِيقُ صَدْرِي. My chest becomes tight when I'm frustrated. What's implied here is this frustration. وَلَا يَنْطَلِقُ لِسَانِي. And my tongue stops articulating. He's not just talking about his stutter. He's talking about something else too. When he gets extremely angry, he can't communicate his ideas clearly. And he's afraid if he does that, what's going to fail? The mission. The task will suffer. So I fear this shortcoming of mine will come in the way of this task you have given me. وَلَا يَنْطَلِقُ لِسَانِي فَأَرْسِلْ إِلَى هَارُونَ. Beautiful words. Give the responsibility of messengership to Harun also. Make him a messenger too. If I fail, the backup should be there. I'm not important, what's important, he's saying. The mission. So he says, send Harun with me. This is why, because I might fail. Then he goes, Allah Azza wa Jal, then he adds, by the way, وَلَهُمْ عَلَيَّ ذَنْبٌ. And by the way, they have especially against me, they have a rap sheet. They have a crime against me, on file. What's the crime? He killed somebody. فَأَخَافُ أَن يَقْتُلُونَ. I'm afraid that they're going to kill me. He asked for Harun alayhi salam to be hired first. Then he said, I might get killed, which explains why you need Harun in the first place. In case he gets killed, who will still be there to deliver the message? So he's explaining his rationale for putting Harun in place. SubhanAllah. He's not afraid of being killed. He's afraid of the mission not being accomplished. SubhanAllah. Alayhi salam. فَأَخَافُ أَن يَقْتُلُونَ. قَالَ كَلَّا. Allah said to him, no. فَذْهَبَا. Both of you go. The beginning of the dialogue is between Allah and Musa. And Allah says, who goes? Both of you. What is already understood? He granted the dua. Both of you go. فَذْهَبَ بِآيَاتِنَا. Go with our signs, our miraculous signs. Then he says, إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ مُسْتَمِعُونَ. We are going to be listening to you. We are going to be in the listening audience among you. Allah says about himself. Now the thing is, Allah could have said, we're going to be watching you. Right? He could have said, we're going to be watching you. You can watch someone from a distance. But to listen to someone, where do you have to be? Allah is showing His ma'iyyah, His closeness. He wants Musa alayhi salam to feel that Allah is close to him, He's supporting him. So we're listening to him. Allah says we're going to be listening. Also, Allah has given us another lesson here. Allah says we're going to be listening carefully to what? The dialogue that takes place between you and who? Fir'aun. So if Allah says He will be listening carefully, what should we be doing? Listen carefully. This dialogue has a lot to offer. That's why we should be listening carefully. فَأْتِيَا فِرْعَوْنَ. Then now watch the transition. فَأْتِيَا فِرْعَوْنَ. Both of you then go to Fir'aun. فَقُولَ. Then both of you say, إِنَّا رَسُولُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. We are both like one messenger of the Lord of the worlds. We're inseparable. They didn't say we are messengers. They said we are messengers, singular. You can't separate us. إِنَّا رَسُولُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. أَنْ أَرْسِلْ مَعَنَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. The first thing they're supposed to say, we are the messenger of the Lord of the worlds. The second thing they're supposed to say is, deliver with us Bani Israel. Send Bani Israel with us. Leave them from your captivity. You guys know the children of Israel were slaves, right? They were under captivity of Fir'aun. So two demands. First demand, we are messenger of the Lord of the worlds. The second demand, send with us Bani Israel. Now I want to show you the transition. قَالَ. Fir'aun said. Wait a second. In the previous ayah, who was talking? Allah was talking to Musa alayhi salam and to Harun indirectly alayhi salam. In the very next ayah, who's responding? Fir'aun. We have been shown a transition. Allah told them to say this. It's understood that they went and they said this. It doesn't have to be repeated. It's redundant. It's understood. But by the way, I want you to picture this. Musa alayhi salam already said he's known as a criminal there. They have a rap sheet against him. He's known for a murder. He's alleged to have murdered somebody. He's a wanted criminal. He's a fugitive. He ran away from that city. He has to go where now? Not sneak into his house. Not on the outskirts of the city. Where does he have to go? To the palace, where there are the majority of the guards. The chances of getting killed would be highest when you go towards the police station. Right? He has to go towards them. He walks into the castle of Fir'aun, stands in front of Fir'aun. Allah protects him thus far. Obviously, he's a fugitive. The police are looking at him funny. Everybody's laughing at them. He's standing next to Harun, who's from the Israelites, who's considered second-class citizens. And Fir'aun is the king. He's on the throne. He's in authority. Obviously, who's in a higher position right now, as it seems? If you look at that scene, who's got the upper hand? Fir'aun's got the upper hand. He's got the upper hand. And now you walk into his court and you say, we are the messengers of the Lord of the worlds? Who claimed that he's the Lord? And you go to him and say, by the way, you're not the Lord. We're actually representing the Lord. You walk to his palace and slap him on the face with that statement. Inna Rasulu Rabbil Alameen. And then he's Lord, and especially he's Lord over the slave nation. What's the second thing you have to say? By the way, your lordship over the slave nation is done. Send them with us. Now imagine this scenario. This is very strange. Musa alayhi salam is in no position apparently to make these claims. But he does. Fir'aun, clever politician. Imagine him sitting arrogantly on his throne, his ministers all around him smirking as Musa alayhi salam is talking. What's he talking about? He says, Qala. Fir'aun says, Alam nurabbika fina walida. Didn't we raise you as a boy among us? Didn't I let you live among us as a boy? Wasn't this a favor? What's he saying to him? You should be coming, begging me at my feet and thanking me that I haven't killed you yet. Here you are coming, talking to me like this. Have you forgotten that I raised you in our home as a child? You disloyal. See, he's insulting the character of Musa. Did he respond to any of the things Musa said, by the way? No. He's clever. He's trying to test the psychological firmness of Musa alayhi salam. He's trying to throw him off his feet. Didn't we raise you as a boy among us? وَلَبِثْتَ فِينَا مِنْ عُمُرِكَ سِنِينَ. And you spent many years voluntarily with us. It's not like we held you. You spent them, لَبِثَ, to stay voluntarily. You stayed with us for many years. Who are you to talk like this in between the lines? وَفَعَلْتَ فَعْلَتَكَ الَّتِي فَعَلْتَ. And you did that thing that you did. See the way he said it? You did that act of yours that you had done. What is that act? He didn't say you killed someone. He's trying to make him nervous. You want me to tell everyone what you did? You know that thing? You see, he's intimidating Musa alayhi salam. وَفَعَلْتَ فَعْلَتَكَ الَّتِي فَعَلْتَ. وَأَنْتَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. And you're from those who deny? You're from those who deny my favor? You're from those who deny that you murdered? Kafir is to deny. So now Fir'aun is trying to put himself in this more intimidating position and put Musa alayhi salam down. Musa alayhi salam responds, قال فعلتها إذن. Yeah, I did that then. By the way, Fir'aun had said, I raised you as a boy, you stayed with us for many years, and you killed someone. Three things. Of these three things, what's the most important allegation against Musa? The third. So he responds to that one first, because he's an intelligent man, he needs to get rid of the biggest hurdle first. I did that, I committed that act then. وَأَنَا مِنَ الضَّالِّينَ, and I was from those who were misled. I was confused. I was conned into it. I did it, I admit it. He admits it. Gets that out of the way first. He's not a kafir of it anymore. He's not in denial of that anymore. Then he says, فَفَرَرْتُ مِنْكُمْ. Beautiful. I ran away from you. لَمَّا خِفْتُكُمْ. When I used to be scared of you. لَمَّا خِفْتُكُمْ. When I used to be scared of you. What's he telling him? It's not working. I'm not scared of you. I had run away when I was scared of you, and I have come back as a sign. It's already an indication that what? I'm not scared of you. لَمَّا خِفْتُكُمْ فَوَهَبَ لِي رَبِّي حُكْمًا. And my real Lord, my Lord, He granted me wisdom and firmness. وَجَعَلَنِي مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. He made me from those who have been sent. Meaning I haven't come back to visit, I have been sent on a mission. The first thing he said was he's a messenger. Now he's coming back to the same subject because he's not letting himself be distracted by the side arguments. He comes back to the main point. I have been sent. Comes back to the same thing he started with. Fir'aun was trying to change the subject. The politician that he is, he doesn't want to answer the question, he wants to change the subject. Start a new controversy. Sound familiar? Right? And so this, Musa alayhi salam doesn't get dissuaded. He stays on point. I have been sent from, those who have been sent. He's made me from those who've been sent. وَتِلْكَ نِعْمَةٌ تَمُنُّهَا عَلَيَّ. And by the way, that favor you speak of, what favor? You raised me. You did favor that upon me, I agree. أَنْ عَبَّدْتَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. He poses a question. So you did that favor to me, and as a result, you have a right to enslave Bani Israel. Is that what you're trying to say? He tries to question the rationale of Fir'aun. Remember the second demand of Musa? What was it? So deliver Bani Israel. He says to him, by the way, you're saying that you raised me as a boy. Thanks, by the way, you did do that favor. What does that have to do with enslaving Bani Israel? What are you talking about? You see, Musa alayhi salam didn't move from the point. And he showed the lack of rationale in Fir'aun's line of thinking, which is already an insult to the intellect of Fir'aun in front of the entire audience. Who is the audience? The high caliber ministers of Fir'aun. They're the ones in the palace, right? The loyalists. And in front of all of them, oh, you know, that's what happens to Fir'aun. Now look, قال فرعون. Fir'aun is now stumped. He doesn't have any choice but to address the subject at hand. So what does he say? وَمَا رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. What Lord of the worlds are you talking about? He didn't even say, وَمَنْ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Who's the Lord of the worlds? He didn't say who, he said, what? You know, when you say what, you're saying it doesn't even exist. When you say who, then you're trying to figure out who it is. But when you say what, you're trying to say, it's just a fathom of your, it's just a figure of your imagination. What are you talking about? What Lord of the worlds? And he thought by insulting Musa alayhi salam like that, what Lord of the worlds? Like that. What's he gonna say now? Musa alayhi salam takes that opportunity and stabs him right where it hurts. Look, qala, Musa alayhi salam said, رَبُّ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. The Lord of the heavens and the earth. By the way, the pharaohs used to worship the sun. Which is where? In the sky? He's the Lord, and he claims that the sun is the Lord. That's what they claimed. So Musa tells him, by the way, he's not just your Lord, by the way. He's Lord of what? The heavens. And you're the king on the earth? He's the Lord of the earth too. رَبُّ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا. And everything in between. SubhanAllah. رَبُّ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا إِن كُنْتُمْ مُوقِنِينَ. He didn't say إِن كُنْتَ مُوقِنًا. He didn't say if you are seeking conviction. You know what he did? He said, you're useless. I don't even want to talk to you. I've already beat you. I'm going to talk to the rest of your crew here. So he says, the Lord of the heavens and the earth and everything in between, if all of you are seeking to be convinced. He turned away from Musa, from Fir'aun. He turned to them. كُنْتُمْ is plural. He turned to them. again, another slap on Fir'aun's face, because now Musa is like, I don't have to talk to you. You're worth it. You're not worth it. إِن كُنْتُمْ مُوقِنِينَ. Now look. قَالَ لِمَنْ حَوْلَهُ. Fir'aun now listens, all of these people around him are being stunned by Musa alayhi salam. Fir'aun's getting nervous. So what does he say? He says to those who were around him, قَالَ لِمَنْ حَوْلَهُ, أَلَا تَسْتَمِعُونَ. Are you not listening carefully enough to what he's saying? Do you realize what he's saying? Meaning he's saying, listening to him is an insult to me. You are being disloyal to the kingship. Do you realize that? So he's trying to alert his people to stay under his rank by scaring them first. The first tactic was fear. أَلَا تَسْتَمِعُونَ. Musa alayhi salam says, well, he's getting nervous, might as well take an advantage of this opportunity some more. قَالَ رَبُّكُمْ وَرَبُّ أَبَائِكُمْ الْأَوَّلِينَ. Not just your Lord, all of you, but the Lord of your ancient forefathers who you believe were gods too. He's their Lord too. He's not talking to Fir'aun right now, he's talking to the audience. رَبُّكُمْ وَرَبُّ أَبَائِكُمْ الْأَوَّلِينَ. First he was the Lord of the heavens and the earth and everything in between. Now he brings it home, even your Lord. Not just the skies and the earth, your Lord too. And the Lord of your forefathers. Now they're really like, they can't stop but listen to Musa alayhi salam. They're stunned by him. So what does Fir'aun do? Now he's getting desperate. By the way, when I started this dialogue, Fir'aun was up here and Musa was down here. Have you noticed the shift? Fir'aun is getting nervous. The people are listening to Musa alayhi salam. There's a shift in the balance of dialogue power. This dialogue is changing momentum. And now look, Fir'aun gets frustrated. He says, قَالَ إِنَّ رَسُولَكُمْ الَّذِي أُرْسِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ لَمَجْنُونَ. He said, this messenger of yours? By the way, he didn't say the messenger. He said, this messenger of yours. Meaning, it illustrates that the people were actually listening carefully, so much so that Fir'aun had to say, your messenger. He didn't just say this man, he said, رَسُولَكُمْ, your messenger. You're listening to him like he's your messenger. By the way, this messenger that has been sent to you, أُرْسِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ, was he sent to them or to Fir'aun first? He was sent to Fir'aun. But Fir'aun doesn't want to accept that. So he directs it, he was sent to you guys. لَمَجْنُونَ, he's insane. He's crazy. Now watch this carefully. The first attack on the personality of Musa was loyalty. We raised you as a boy. The second attack was the crime, right? His track record. The third attack is his sanity. He's insane. لمجنون. Now watch. قَالَ رَبُّ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. Musa alayhi salam doesn't stop. He doesn't have to respond, no, I'm not crazy. He says, I'm going to stay on point and let him stumble. Let him trip over himself. Musa alayhi salam says, the Lord of the East and the West. And then he says, وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا, whatever's in between the East and the West. If all of you are really thinking about it, if you are seeking to apply your intellects, then what I'm telling you is very convincing. Now he is upset because the people have shifted their attention from Fir'aun to who? To Musa. And this is his cabinet. This is his administration. So he is so upset, he says, قَالَ. He says to Musa alayhi salam, لَإِنِ اتَّخَذْتَ إِلَهًا غَيْرِي. If you dare take anyone worthy of worship except me, لَأَجْعَلَنَّكَ مِنَ الْمَسْجُونِينَ. There is no doubt about it, I will make you from those who have been imprisoned. Meaning, people have already been imprisoned for showing disloyalty, and I will consider this an act of treason, and I will put you in prison. When do you threaten someone? When you can't beat them in argument, then you try to overpower them with your muscle. So the fact that he threatened Musa alayhi salam with prison was in and of itself a proof that he has lost the debate. That was already a proof that he's lost. Because if he hadn't lost, he would have more arguments. This is not an argument, this is just a threat. No answer. He's got no answer, he's been stumped already. Now Musa alayhi salam responds, قَالَ أَوَلَوْ جِئْتُكَ بِشَيْءٍ مُبِينٍ. Okay, I'll be in prison, even if I bring you a clear proof from what I'm talking about. Let's stay on the ideas, instead of turning to your threats. You want to deal with this matter? Let's get it over with. Maybe I don't have anything to show you. Even if I bring you something clear, a clarifying evidence. Now Fir'aun is, everybody's like, what's he going to do? Musa alayhi salam challenged him. He's going to back down from the challenge? Then obviously who won? Musa. And everybody will be talking afterwards, oh my God, Fir'aun really got it today. I can't let that happen, Fir'aun says. I got to take him on. I don't have a choice. He's been backed into a corner. So he says, fine. قَالَ فَأْتِ بِهَا. Go ahead, bring it if you're from the truthful. He's nervous now. And now Musa alayhi salam brings what? His asa, his staff. It turns into a snake. He takes his hand out and it's white. And as he's watching that, now you're thinking of, what can I do? What can I do to make people not look at that? The words were amazing enough and now they see this. What's the best way to stop this from going on? What did he say? He says, قَالَ لِلْمَلَأِ حَوْلَهُ. But before it was لِمَنْ حَوْلَهُ, by the way. He spoke to whoever was around him. Now it says he spoke to the chiefs around him. Because what must he have noticed? The chiefs were impressed. And if the chiefs are impressed, there can be a coup. You know that, right? When the generals are turning, then there can be a change. So you got to keep your generals close. So he says, وَقَالَ لِلْمَلَأِ حَوْلَهُ إِنَّ هَذَا لَسَاحِرٌ عَلِيمٌ. This is a knowledgeable magician. How can he be crazy and a knowledgeable magician at the same time? Either you're a PhD in physics or you are in the psych ward. You can't be both. In the same dialogue, he started first by saying what? He's crazy. Then he turned, that didn't work. Let's come up with something new. And what's the new one? He's a very good magician. SubhanAllah. He actually disproved his own self. The people around him are very smart. They know that he's already changed the story a few times. Which means he's desperate to find something to defeat what he sees that cannot be defeated. It can't be defeated, so he's desperate to come up with new stuff. يُرِيدُ أَن يُخْرِجَكُمْ. And this is where we'll end, inshallah. يُرِيدُ أَن يُخْرِجَكُمْ مِنْ أَرْضِكُمْ بِسِحْرِهِ. He intends to get you out of your land by means of his magic. He is a threat to national security. If you listen to him, you will all be deported. What did he just use? First he tried to intimidate Musa, alayhi salam. First he tried to insult him, then to intimidate him, then to accuse him, then to character assassinate him by calling him insane. Then, when none of that worked, I can't scare him anymore. Well, who should I scare now? The people. If I can't scare him, let me scare them into believing that if they follow him, what's going to happen? They'll all be kicked out of their land. Did he say anything about leaving the land? Or kicking people out of their land? He wants to leave the land with who? With Bani Israel. He said no such thing. But you know, as a political leader, the smart thing is to rally people on your cause, whether it's right or not. The best glue that will bring people together is fear against an enemy. That's the best glue. So Fir'aun realizes that's the only thing I got left. So the only attack this time is actually not an attack on Musa directly, alayhi salam, but it's actually a means to unify his people, to bring them, rally the troops again. يُرِيدُ أَن يُخْرِجَكُمْ مِنْ أَرْضِكُمْ بِسِحْرِهِ. He wants to get you out of your land by his magic. And by the way, who commands in Egypt? Who had the command? Fir'aun. Look at this ayah. فَمَاذَا تَأْمُرُونَ. What do you guys say? Whose opinion did he ask? The people's. Because he saw that the people are not listening to him. So he wanted to make the people feel included in the process. So he could keep them loyal. He was losing the loyalty. Because normally what would Fir'aun say? Who has commanded? Whose opinion is this? Mine, my way or no way. But now he's forced to say, فَمَاذَا تَأْمُرُونَ. What do you guys think? He's been humbled. He's been overpowered just by the words that were given to Musa alayhi salam. Just by that. Dialogue is one of the most powerful means of communicating messages in the Quran. It's not just this one said this one said that. Every piece of the dialogue, as I tried to illustrate to you, has powerful, you know, implications that are very difficult to communicate in paragraphs. I have to stop at every line and give you 6, 7, 8 lines, 2, 3 minutes. But the way it's captured so eloquently, woven together, it's incredible. It really is. So the point that I want to drive home, inshallah, and I'm done, bi-idhnillah, jazakumullahu khairan for your attention, is as follows. The Qur'an is remarkable, stunning, mesmerizing literature. You have never read anything in your life that will come close to having the impact, not just from the religious point of view, but even from the psychological point of view. You will not be affected by anything that you will ever listen to or read like you will be by the Qur'an. The tragedy of our times is that we have reduced the Qur'an to translation and reduced the Qur'an to certain isolated quotations by virtue of which we actually don't get to see the power in which it is communicating its message. And this is a big problem. By the way, the scholars of the Arabs don't have this problem. They see it. They see the beauty. This is a problem mostly for the majority of the people of this ummah who are suffering from iman deficit to begin with. And if they saw this miracle and they saw that mesmerizing power of the Qur'an, at least heard about it on a regular basis, we would necessarily see a change in attitudes. A change in the regard, the awe, the inspiration we take from this Qur'an. It would be a different relationship. The dynamics of that relationship would change.